Today, since we just gave sort of the overview of memory last time, for today and the next couple of days through to the end of this week, we're going to be taking a much more in-depth, small-scale look at the kinds of changes that happen with memory. And before we get to that, we actually need to sort of catch up a little bit to something that I had hoped to cover in the first chance, but didn't have the time to, which is a discussion of how neurons actually communicate why we even care about actual communication in the first place. Cool, fun, big electrical events that happen in neurons, but the real value of action potentials is that they aid in the communication of information between one neuron and another. And so we're going to discuss synaptic communication in two parts. The first, I'm going to sort of move over to the whiteboard over there because we're going to want to have things up for the, sort of add to some things throughout the course of the hour and a half, is talking about what's called release, which is after one neuron fires an action potential, what happens to allow it to send a signal to the next neuron. And then the second part is to talk about the receiving of that neuron, of that signal in the next neuron in the sequence, and how that affects that neuron's activity. Once we've gotten through that material, then we're going to move on to the link between that and memory. And one of the main ways that memory happens is that synapses change. And that's actually not the only way that memories happen, but in order for a memory to be stored, something has to be different about your brain before you learned some fact versus after you learned that fact. And so something needs to change in the brain. And we have a very large, in some sense, there's a lot of debate about sort of like how large, and then it's even hard to quantify in terms exactly of like bytes and so on that computers use, but estimates range around 10 terabytes of data storage capacity in our brains. Our brains don't work exactly like computers, so it's a little bit of a difficult analogy to maintain, but we do have large capacity for memory. You know, you can remember the face of every person you've ever met, and even if you don't remember their name and have like sort of immediate access to the link between name and face, if you see somebody that you met 5 years ago, you will recognize that person as familiar. And so in the course of your life, you've met probably 10,000 people. And having 10,000 faces stored is quite a lot of visual memory that you've got running around in your brain. And so there's a lot of storage capacity that your brain has. In your brain, there are the latest estimate is somewhere around 86 billion neurons in your brain. Which is a large number. It's close to the number of stars in our galaxy, so it's quite a large number of neurons in your brain. But actually more impressive than that is that each of those neurons will have, on average, about 1,000 outputs that it makes, and also on average about 1,000 inputs that it collects information from. And so that means that there's somewhere around 86 to 100 trillion connections in your brain. And if every connection can be changed, then that provides a huge storage capacity for memory. And so that's one of the reasons why synapses and these connections, because they're so numerous, and because we've learned so much about how they actually do change, are thought to be major players in how memory works. So that's sort of where we're going. And the reason why we're going to spend 3 days on this material. Before we get into that, I wanted to move over here and give a general overview about synaptic communication in general and what happens after a neuron fires an action potential. And so, like I said, or like we talked about last time, we're going to be focusing a little bit on the hippocampus. And in the hippocampus, there are a whole lot of external inputs. Coming in, and these external inputs carry information about what you see, what you hear, what you smell, all different types of, you know, somatosensation, things like pain, temperature, touch, vibration sense, and so on. All of that's coming in. The hippocampus is one of several places in your brain that a lot of this processed and organized and sort of re-evaluated information all comes together. So one of the things we're going to talk about in the next unit is how sensory information goes from sort of raw sensory data into more highly processed perceptions about the world. And so those highly processed sensory perceptions end up getting brought into the hippocampus, and in particular into an area of the hippocampus called CA3. It is one area that collects a lot of this information. And in CA3, there are, in a human brain, maybe 20 or 30,000 neurons, and they are collectively gathering a lot of this sensory data and also doing some further processing on it. And the output coming out of the CA3 neurons, so like all neurons, or the CA3 neurons have dendrites, which are the main source of input, the cell body, which is where all of the machinery for keeping the neuron alive lives, including the nucleus, and then an axon, which is an output structure. And they have this characteristic sort of pyramidal shape with one large dendrite coming off the top and a few smaller dendrites extending off the cell body in various directions. And then, like all neurons, they have a single axon coming out. And collectively, so if we have a few other CA, they're all about the same size, but I'm going to draw some of them smaller. So if we have a few other CA3 neurons, then they're also going to have axons coming out. And collectively, the group of axons is called the Schaefer collateral. And so CA3 neurons send their axons to other neurons that are essentially the same sort of shape, pyramidal cell, with a large dendrite and a few smaller ones coming off, and then these neurons are named CA1. They got the names before we knew how they were connected, and so like everything in biology, it's like half backwards and upside down, why 3 comes before 1 and what the heck happened to 2, I'd be happy to discuss some of the history if anyone wants to, but it's not a very exciting story. It's just sort of like things happen in the order they're discovered. And so these axons might make a few branches, maybe something like this. And so one axon from one CA3 neuron might have 3 places where it makes synaptic connections onto the CA1 neuron. And it also will have other branches that connect up with other with some other CA3 neuron over here, and then this cell, meanwhile, might also have some connection over to this one. Maybe it branches and makes a connection over here. It can kind of end up being a tangled, fiery mess. But we're, right now, going to be focusing in on one of these synaptic connections here. Okay. So that's sort of the overall architecture of what's going on. So what questions do people have about like this arrangement, the branching axons, the numbers of contacts and so on that are going on in the system? Yeah, sure.
So one signal can be sent to multiple different.
Yes, yeah. So if this neuron here fires an action potential, then that action potential is going to travel down this axon and travel along all of these different branches. And then that action potential is going to reach all of these presynaptic terminals. And in fact, this axon is going to branch many, many times. And there might be 1,000 or 2,000synaptic terminals. So this area here is called the presynaptic terminal. And I'll draw that a little bit larger up on the chalkboard in just a second. But there might be a couple thousand presynaptic terminals that all get that one action potential that happens, that one neuron gets all of those couple thousand presynaptic terminals. Other questions about that? Yeah,
sure.
So the CA3 neuron is going to be our neuron that's sending information. It got some inputs somewhere else, but it's the one that we're going to be focusing on as the sender, and then the CA1 neuron is going to be our receiver of information. And it also has an axon, and this axon is going to go back out to a lot of different brain structures. So a lot of different sensory information comes in, it gets processed and converted into, one of the things that the hippocampus does in terms of processing in general, as I'm standing here, I'm sort of aware of my own perception of the room, you know, the doors over there relative to me, the boards over here, the blackboards behind me, the screen projectors over there, all of that. I have this sort of representation of relative to my body where things are. And then I also have a perception of sort of, relative to the room as seen from some sort of bird's eye view where I am and where things are. And one of the things that the hippocampus does is convert between a sort of egocentric representation of the world relative to me versus what we call an allocentric representation, which is the world sort of as seen from above or as seen from a third person perspective. A lot of people will report that recent memories, often if you imagine something that happened to you this morning, you will imagine it from a sort of egocentric perspective of like you sitting there, you see the bowl of cereal you were eating for breakfast and putting it in your mouth. Whereas if you're remembering something that happened to you a couple of years ago, people tend to remember it from a more sort of third person perspective. And so one of the ideas is that by converting from this, so the, whatever processing the hippocampus does in part converts between one perspective and another, and the third person perspective is probably a little bit easier for our brains to store because you don't have to remember like all of the sensory data of every little thing you saw. And so instead you can just have sort of a narrative story. And so what the hippocampus is doing is processing the information to build a narrative story. And in building this narrative story, it's allowing you to store that memory in a more long-term way. And that can be true for, spatial organization as well as other aspects about, like, the social environment that you're in or the mental state that you're in, whether you're focused or tired or whatever. There are a lot of different things that can be sort of seen either as a first-person or third-person perspective. And the hippocampus, by converting between those, allows you to create a narrative that can then be stored more easily than storing every little bit of every sensory data of where every point of light is that you're seeing and every vibration that you're hearing and so on and so forth. You kind of can build a story out of it. And that's what the hippocampus is doing. And so we're focusing in on this because in the conversion of sensory data coming in versus axon going out, is where this story is probably being built somewhere in this hippocampal circuitry. And so, and that story turns out to be critical to remembering facts and events for a long term, and that's why people with damage to the hippocampus can't remember something. Often, depending on how severe the damage is, maybe they lose things after a few hours, maybe they lose things after just a few minutes. One of the videos, actually, that's on the YouTube memory playlist that I emailed out is about somebody who has a memory, such severe damage to his hippocampus that his memory only lasts for a few seconds. Yeah, other questions about that? Okay, so again, that's sort of like why we're focused in on this, because we know from humans that hippocampus, and also from animal studies, that hippocampus is vital for the formation of these certain declarative memories about facts and events. And we want to see what's changing in the hippocampus, and one nice candidate for what's changing in the hippocampus is this synaptic connection between CA3 neurons and CA1 neurons. So if we zoom in a little bit more on the synaptic connection and make it a lot bigger here. So here's our CA1 dendrite, CA3 axon, and then this is our big fat synaptic connection. So this space here is called the synapse. Synapse just is Latin for, derives from the Latin for space. So there is some space between this cell and this cell. And so before that space, we have our presynaptic terminal. Terminal because it's the end of the axon, presynaptic because it comes before the space. We sometimes also call this our presynaptic neuron because with respect to this particular connection, it comes before the synapse. And then so we have here our CA3 dendrite. There's in here, sort of all of this is a postsynaptic site, a postsynaptic location, and we sometimes refer to this CA1 neuron as the postsynaptic cell. With respect to this connection, it comes after the synapse. It's got its own axon that's going out, and so it's going to be presynaptic with respect to other neurons. Just like this cell has some dendrites, and relative to those, it is the receiver, so it's postsynaptic for those others. But with respect, so if you talk about cell pre versus postsynaptic, it's a matter of, with respect to a particular connection that you're focused on, does it come before or after that connection? Questions about that idea? So neurons receive and send information, so they're all pre- and postsynaptic to somebody. But with respect to this connection, this one's going to be pre, this is pre, this is post. So inside here we have these membrane-bound spheres, which are called vesicles, or sometimes synaptic vesicles. And then they are chock full of neurotransmitter. In this case, the neurotransmitter is glutamate, which happens to be the most common neurotransmitter in the brain. About 90% of the neurons in your brain release glutamate. There are some other neurotransmitters. So one other neurotransmitter is something called GABA, which we'll talk about and return to very briefly in a little bit. That's the second most common, so this is about 90% of the neurons. So this CA3 neuron, every one of its synapses, all 2,000 that it makes, all release glutamate. Some cells, the neurotransmitter they release is GABA. and account for about 5% of your brain, of the cells in your brain. Any other neurotransmitters people know about, heard of? Sure, yeah, Jack?
Dopamine,
sure, yeah. Anything else? Sure, yeah.
Acetylcholine?
Acetylcholine, yeah. Others, anyone else has heard of? You've heard of that.
Yeah.
Serotonin. Endorphins are another. There are actually a few. There are actually probably a few dozen different neurotransmitters in your brain. But collectively, all of these others make up a pretty small fraction of the neurons in your brain. They're found in particular brain regions that release serotonin sort of all over the brain, or release acetylcholine all over the brain, and have very important effects in terms of mood and diseases and so on. And if you take, those of you that are in CMU, if you come to CMU and take some advanced neuroscience classes, then we talk about dopamine, acetylcholine, serotonin, and with regards to different neurobiological diseases and so on and so forth. But for this course, we're going to be focusing mostly on glutamate with a little bit about GABA. Okay, so, and one other thing about neurotransmitters is that in the vesicle, there's about 20,000 molecules of neurotransmitter, and that's a constant thing. Unless the neuron unless you put on some really bizarre drugs that totally mess up the neuron's function, there's going to be in every vesicle that same 20,000 molecules of neurotransmitter. So it's sort of a constant thing that's present there.
So,
yeah?
You're saying that in every vesicle there's, is it all just one type of chemical, or is it all?
For a particular neuron, this is a bit of an oversimplification, but we're going to go with it. For a particular neuron, every synapse it has, every vesicle there, releases one type of neurotransmitter. So these CA3 neurons, every synaptic contact they make, every vesicle in every one of those synaptic contacts is full of glutamate.
Okay.
And then there are other neurons who release just GABA, or just serotonin, just acetylcholine. Other questions about that? Okay, so now what the heck goes on with an action potential? So we have some action potential, which is a big depolarization, and then followed by appetite polarization. It's happened first over in the cell body of the cell, and then it traveled down along the axon, and it reaches this this presynaptic terminal. And sitting in this presynaptic terminal are another type of channel that we haven't talked about yet, called voltage-activated calcium channels. And so, like the name implies, they are voltage-activated, just like our voltage-activated sodium channel, voltage-activated potassium channel were. And so, when this depolarization from the action potential reaches the presynaptic terminal, these channels will go from being closed to being open because there's been a big voltage change. And if you remember, the concentration of calcium inside a neuron is about a thousandth of a millimolar, and the concentration of calcium outside the neuron is somewhere around one millimolar. So that's a 1,000-fold difference, and that means that essentially calcium, the reversal potential for calcium ends up being somewhere around plus 120 or plus 150 millivolts, the equilibrium potential, which means that even at the very peak of this action potential, if it's up at plus 40 millivolts or whatever, calcium is still flowing into the neuron. So calcium always flows in. And then that calcium that flows in will stick to proteins that live on these vesicles here. And when the calcium comes in and sticks to this protein, there is a probability that this vesicle here will make its membrane continuous with the membrane of the cell, and so then all of the neurotransmitter inside diffuses out into the synaptic space. So let me just kind of write that down. So we've got our action potential arrives at our presynaptic terminal, voltage activated, calcium channels open, calcium goes in, and then there's some probability that calcium will bind to a vesicle and then cause it to release its contents. Into the synapse. And if it does, then we've got our chemical signal that's being sent out. Okay, so what questions do people have about that? Yeah, sure.
The probability lies in whether the calcium is going to bond to the proteins on the vesicle, or whether the vesicle...
Yeah, a little bit of both. There's a little bit of a probabilistic interaction in terms of whether calcium binds to the vesicle, and also a little bit of a probabilistic interaction of where it binds, whether it's going to go, whether it's going to release. Yeah. Other questions about that? Okay. So that's part one, release. Part two is then what goes on in the cell that's receiving this signal, the receptors. So this particular contact, this particular synapse, is released, the presynaptic cell is releasing glutamate, so our postsynaptic cell needs to have some proteins that are sensitive to that glutamate chemical. And so what we're going to find here is a couple of different types of what are called ligand-gated ion channels, if you're a cell biologist, which is equivalent to calling them ionotropic receptors, which is what neurobiologists tend to call them. And all that means is that it's an ion channel. Just like our sodium, just like our voltage-activated sodium ion channel, or our voltage-activated potassium ion channel, or our leak ion channels that are always open, this is an ion channel. But unlike the leak channels that are always open, or our voltage-activated channels that respond to changes in voltage, this responds to a ligand or a chemical signal. So it's a receptor for a particular chemical, in this case, glutamate. So our ligand-gated ion channels, what that means is when glutamate is not there, they're closed, and when glutamate is there, they open, and so ions can flow through. And so glutamate sticks to these guys, and that opens the channel, and the main type that is critical for sort of day-to-day synaptic communication are what I called, before I called them AMPA channels, but they're actually more properly called AMPA-type glutamate receptors. They are a glutamate receptor. The chemical in your brain that activates them is glutamate, but it happens that there's an artificial drug called AMPA, which also activates them. You never find AMPA in your brain, but we call them, or we sometimes just shorten them as AMPA receptors. For short, but when you think about AMPA receptors, you should remember that glutamate is the real thing in a brain that's actually activating them. They get a name, the because there are different types of glutamate receptors, and we name these based on the particular drug that activates them. So we've got our AMPA-type glutamate receptors, and as we talked about before with those, they allow both potassium to leave and sodium to come in, but because the driving force for sodium is so much stronger than the driving force for potassium, when this cell is below action potential threshold, they are going to depolarize the neuron and bring it closer to the point where it's going to fire an action potential. And so we call, we therefore say that glutamate is excitatory because it excites this neuron, this receiving cell, is getting excited and getting brought closer to firing its own action potential by glutamate. What questions do people have about that? Yeah, sure.
Is the AMPA the synthetic drug that you talked about?
Yeah, AMPA is a synthetic drug, yeah.
Is it an agonist for the receptor?
Yeah, it's agonist. That's a term that we don't use. But it's something that activates, yeah. So glutamate activates and opens the channel, and AMPA is an agonist that also activates and opens the channel. Yeah. So that's, you can also have drugs that are antagonists that prevent, and actually we will talk about some of those antagonists. You can have drugs that block glutamate from binding to the AMPA receptor and so prevent this signal. And that's actually going to be important for one of the things we'll talk about at the end of class today or at the beginning of class tomorrow. What other questions do people have about that? Okay, before we actually move on to going into more detail about these glutamate synapses, I just wanted to talk very briefly about GABA synapses. So we might have over here some inhibitory neuron, and that inhibitory neuron again has an axon, presynaptic terminal, a synapse, and then it might make contact somewhere else on a dendrite of some receiving cell. And just like before, it's got these vesicles filled with 20,000 molecules each of neurotransmitter. It has voltage-activated calcium channels. And when there's an action potential here, these voltage-activated calcium channels open, calcium comes in. Again, there's a probability that it's going to stick to and trigger the fusion of this membrane and the release of, now, instead of glutamate, the release, so our neurotransmitter, is GABA. And then instead of finding glutamate receptors, such as the AMPA-type glutamate receptor over here, instead we will find over here receptors that are GABA receptors. And the main type of GABA receptor is called a GABA-A receptor. There are GABA-Bs that are a little bit different, but the GABA-A receptor is another, it is a GABA-gated ion channel. So when GABA fills the synapse and GABA binds to this, it opens up, and into the cell flows some negatively charged chloride ions, and those have the effect of making the inside of the cell more negative, which means it pulls the cell away from threshold, and so the cell is less likely to fire an action potential following this. And so we call this, therefore, that's why these neurons are called inhibitory. They inhibit the receiving cell from firing action potentials. And so I talked about GABA channels before. They're more properly referred to as GABA-A receptors or just GABA receptors. And those are the ones that receive the inhibitory input from different neurons. So these are different neurons. This is not a CA3 neuron, but rather a completely different neuron, and its only job is when it gets activated, it releases GABA at all of its targets, and then inhibits those targets from firing from direction. Yeah, sure.
The name CA3, it doesn't have anything to do with calcium, does it?
No, yeah, it's one of the, it's cornu amonis area 3, and the hippocampus has this sort of curvy shape, and some early neuroanatomists thought that it looked like a horn, and so cornu means horn. Amon, I think, is I can't remember whether it's a Greek god or the neuroanatomist who discovered it. But it's somebody's name, I don't know. One of the many unfortunate names that's like, oh my god, calcium and CA mean something else. Anyway,
So the GABA A receptors are triggered by glutamate still?
No, they're triggered by GABA. GABA was a different neurotransmitter, the different neurons release. Yeah, good. Yeah, and that's a very important point to make sure we're clear about. So different neurons that instead of releasing glutamate as their job is to release GABA. Other questions? Okay. So I'm going to give myself a little bit of extra space here in the dendrites and over here. So in addition to our AMPA receptors, there's a second type of postsynaptic receptor that we find in excitatory synapses. And that second type of a postsynaptic receptor would be most properly called an NMDA type glutamate receptor, although we often just shorten it as NMDA receptors. And the NMDA type glutamate receptors have some similarities as well as some differences to the AMPA receptors. So, like the full name implies, they are a receptor for glutamate. So, just like AMPA receptors, when glutamate is in the synaptic zone, the NMDA receptors bind to that glutamate. But they have a little bit of complexity, and I'm actually going to, we'll go ahead and talk about that right now. So let's zoom in maybe a little bit more on our dendrite. And so over here is our AMPA receptor. Oh, I should mention, the NMDA receptors, they get their name the same way as the AMPA receptors. They're a glutamate receptor, but there's a synthetic drug called NMDA that also activates them, but not these, and AMPA activates these, but not those. And so that's how we can distinguish them in a sort of experimental way, and also how we distinguish them in terms of when we talk about them. And so if you remember back when we were talking about action, there were two channels that we were really focusing on. One was the voltage-activated potassium channels. And those voltage-activated potassium channels are pretty simple. When the cell gets depolarized and positive inside, or a little bit up closer to zero or positive, then they open. And when it's negative, they close. Pretty simple, two things to worry about. The sodium channels, on the other hand, were more complicated. In the sodium channel, they had two things that needed to happen. They had to be open, plus there was that plug that moved in and out. So our AMPA receptors are kind of like those potassium channels. They're pretty simple. Open with glutamate, closed without. The NMDA receptors, on the other hand, are complicated. Sitting outside the neuron on every NMDA receptor is a magnesium ion. And magnesium ions are larger than sodium and potassium ions, and also calcium ions, which are going to be important here in a second. And in addition to being, and so they're large, and they're so large that they can't fit through the NMDA receptor. But they're trying to go through. And it's sort of like if there was a big elephant outside in the hallway, and it was trying to come in through the door. With that big elephant outside trying to come in, nobody's getting in and nobody's getting out because there's a big fat elephant that's just plugged the door. So that's what our magnesium ion is. It's this big fat elephant that's plugged the door. And so it's trying to get in, and one of the reasons it's trying to get in is the cell here inside is negatively charged, the magnesium positively charged, and so there's an electrostatic pull that's pulling those magnesium ions in. And so for our NMDA receptors, when we're anywhere between minus infinity to say minus 55 millivolts, then the NMDA receptors are completely plugged by magnesium. When we're in the range of minus 55 millivolts to say minus 20 millivolts or so, there's a sort of partial plug. They're partially blocked, meaning the magnesium ion is spending, there's some probabilities where some NMDA receptors have a plug in any particular instance and others are not. So this is sort of the partially plugged, or you'll find some plugged and some not. And then when you're at minus 20 millivolts to plus infinity millivolts, anywhere in that range, they're going to be completely unplugged. So either the electrical force pulling that big fat magnesium elephant in has gotten so weak, or it's completely gone, or it's even reversed and the magnesium ion's being pushed away. But anywhere in that range, they're completely unplugged. So what questions do people have about that? Okay, so for the next maybe 3 minutes or so, try and get together in a group and just think about what is it going to take to allow ions to flow through the NMDA receptor. And in particular, what does the presynaptic cell need to be doing and what does the postsynaptic cell need to be doing to let anything pass through our NMDA receptor, pre and post. Let ions flow through our NMDA receptor. So just take about 3 minutes to kind of brainstorm with the group, and then we'll come back and discuss it collectively. So with our NMDA receptor, just like before when we did the sodium channel, there are four different states that we might find our NMDA receptor in. One state where we find our NMDA receptor is closed. So here, this is inside the cell and this is outside the cell, and plugged. And we'll put there's our magnesium ion, plugs it up. Unlike the sodium channel, the plug is on the outside, not the inside. Okay, and then the question that I had for you though is what needs to be going on for us to actually get some current flow through the cell. So anyone want to say what's going to need to happen here? I'm sure you have Noah.
Potentially need to make the vesicles fuse with the membrane of the presynaptic release the neurotransmitters, and the epichannels need to be active.
Right. Okay. Yeah. So over here, our state where we're going to be having current flow across. Is one where we need two things. One, we need some glutamate that came from presynaptic activity, needs to be there. And then also, we need to be somewhere inside our cell, needs to be depolarized. So that our magnesium ion is gone. So that's what we need to let current flow through. Yeah, sure.
What is flowing through?
That's coming up in a minute. But then there are other states that we could get to. So for example, we could have. Presynaptic cell active, glutamates bound here, but still have this magnesium plot. If the postsynaptic cell, is not active, so if the postsynaptic cell is below minus 55 millivolts, which happens to be about where the threshold is. So really, if the postsynaptic cell is not firing action potentials, that magnesium ion, or not really close to firing an action potential, that magnesium ion is going to be plugging it up. And so we're getting nothing coming in, or going in. Nothing's passing through this. So here, this is sort of moving from here to here, is our presynaptic activity moves us right on this plot. And then in addition to that, we could have an event happen where at a bunch of other synapses, not this place, but a whole bunch of other excitatory inputs are firing. And so this postsynaptic cell is depolarized, firing some of its own action potentials. And if that happens, what happens to our magnesium ion? If this cell is really depolarized? Yeah, magnesium ion's all gone, floated away. But no glutamate, channel's still closed, nothing's coming through. And so moving sort of from up to down on this is the top half is when our postsynaptic cell is silent. So postsynaptic cell silent, we're on the top. Postsynaptic cell active, we're in the bottom. Presynaptic cell is quiet, we're over on the left. Presynaptic cell is active, we're over on the right. And the only one that's getting us anything in terms of current flowing is here. Does that make sense? What questions do people have about that? Yeah, sure.
So is the, after this cycle completes, the time it takes for another magnesium ion to plug, is that like a negative?
It's like femtoseconds or something. They're just like, they're really, really fast. So fast that we can consider it instantaneous. There's not a delay like there was with the sodium inactivation rate, where it's delayed by a couple of milliseconds. Yeah, other questions about that? Yeah, sure.
So it goes like in either direction.
Yeah, I mean, so if the presynaptic cell is silent, then we're going to be over here. And one moment in time the presynaptic cell is active, we go over here, and then wait a few milliseconds, the presynaptic cell stops releasing glutamate, we're going to go back to the left. At another moment in time, the postsynaptic cell is active, we're going to move down in this plot. A couple milliseconds later, maybe the postsynaptic cell finishes action potential, we're going to move back up. Yeah, so we're sort of can go in any direction on that. Yeah. What other questions do you have about that? Okay. So what needs to happen is we say coincident pre and post synaptic activity. In other words, there are two requirements. We need glutamate and our postsynaptic cell to be active. And if either of those is missing, we're not going to get anything to flow through our NMD or something. And so we often refer to the NMDA receptor as a coincidence detector because it detects, it responds to simultaneous or nearly simultaneous activity of both pre- and postsynaptic cells. So they both need to be active at the same moment in time for this NMDA receptor to let anything in. Okay, questions about that? Okay, and then to get back to the question that was just asked, what do they do? What goes in through them? So our NMDA receptors, just like our AMPA receptors, let sodium and potassium flow through. That's kind of not super relevant for their function. What's most relevant for our considerations is they also, unlike the AMPA receptors, allow calcium to flow through. And this is where things get a little bit confusing, because calcium over here in the presynaptic cell increases the probability that a vesicle fuses. Calcium over here in the postsynaptic cell is going to turn out to trigger a strengthening of the synapse. So I'll just write that down and then we'll unpack it in a little bit. But this causes our synapse to get stronger. Incidentally, how could you make this? So we've got some connection here, this cell to this cell. If I wanted to make it stronger, what could I do to make it stronger? What might I change about it? Sort of a couple things that have been put up there.
Send a synthetic drug through it?
Sure. I mean, yeah, I could make it stronger by putting some. So, but without, yeah. So if I wanted to make a long lasting alteration to it that strengthened it, so for example, one thing is, so we've got presynaptic cells sending out signal and postsynaptic cells receiving it. So if I want to get a more powerful connection, what could I do in terms of the amount of signal being sent? Keep it the same, more or less, sure.
Increase it?
Yeah, more signal. So if I increase the amount or the probability that a particular contact is going to release neurotransmitter, that's going to make the synapse, on average, stronger. Or if I put in more receptors that sense the same signal that's there, then I'm also going to make it stronger. And that's actually what we're going to be focusing on for the next two class periods after today. And we'll unpack that a little bit more in a bit. What questions do people have so far about this? So that's sort of the overview of synaptic receptors and receiving synaptic signal. And so this is a slide taken out of a different textbook from yours this is from a different earlier edition of the same textbook. Looking at the different types of glutamate receptors, there's this other type called kainate receptors that we're not going to worry about. They're not very common and don't play much of a role in what we're interested in for the purposes of this course. But we have our AMPA receptors and our NMDA receptors that I've talked about. And so if we have a neuron, a postsynaptic neuron, that's sitting at minus 65 millivolts, and the presynaptic neuron, so this is our CA1 neuron here that we're recording from, and we stimulate, we give a little electrical shock to our CA3 axon, then what we will see is some glutamate gets released, some of our AMPA receptors open up. I wish they had kept it blue to match with this slide, but they didn't. Some AMPA receptors open up, And sodium flows in, a little bit of potassium trickles out, but again, the driving force on sodium is stronger, so most of it gets sodium flowing in, and so our CA1 neuron might go from minus 65 millivolts up to maybe like minus 60 millivolts or something like that. And so this is a slide illustrating what I already drew, which is at resting potentials, which is somewhere around minus 65 or minus 70 millivolts, if glutamate binds, nothing's going to come through our NMDA receptors because they're plugged up by that magnesium ion. But if instead the membrane potential is at minus 30, which for almost all neurons is above threshold, meaning that in fact this neuron, this postsynaptic neuron, is firing an action potential, so we need to be close to threshold or in the middle of an action potential, then the magnesium ion comes off, and we get some sodium flowing in, a little bit of potassium trickling out, but very importantly, calcium coming in as well. And the role of that calcium we'll talk about a little bit more later. That's the guy who figured out this whole business about NMDA receptors. And so here is a synaptic connection. And it's cartooned now with a mix of AMPA receptors, the blue guys, and NMDA receptors, which are the little pink guys. And in this, at this moment in time, our postsynaptic neurons at minus 65 millivolts. This presynaptic neuron, we just shocked it, created an action potential in the axon of our CA3 presynaptic neuron, and glutamate has been released, and so that glutamate is going to bind to our AMPA receptors and also to our NMDA receptors, and we're going to see, again, sort of an excitatory event. This EPSP stands for excitatory postsynaptic potential. So it's excitatory because we're getting closer to the threshold, it's postsynaptic because it's happening in the receiving neuron, and it's a potential because it's a change in voltage. That's not something that you're going to be tested on, but just so you understand like what's going on. That is something that we're going to see referred to in some of the studies we'll be talking about in the next couple of classes. Okay. Questions about that? Okay, so the title here says, what's wrong with this picture? There's something wrong with this slide. There's the book made a mistake here. Anyone want to take a shot? Sure, Jack.
On the graph on the right, I don't think that they reach enough. I don't think they reach the voltage for the NMDA receptors to be open.
Yeah, well, they're open, but they're plugged. Yeah, they didn't get unplugged by the. Yeah, exactly right. Yeah, so minus 65 up to maybe minus 60 millivolts, the NMDA receptors are going to be plugged up. So in fact, at the voltage that this figure illustrates, there shouldn't be anything passing through our NMDA receptors. There should be a big fat magnesium ion sitting there plugging them up. We don't have that, but that second requirement of postsynaptic activity, postsynaptic depolarization. Okay. All right. What questions do people have about synaptic communication, the release of neurotransmitter, the signals, the ion channels that sense that signal, anything like that? Yeah, sure.
What's the voltage at the peak?
It doesn't specify, but let's say it goes up to minus 60 millivolts.
Okay.
Yeah. If it went high enough and got up to like minus 50 millivolts and maybe came close to threshold, then we might have some fraction of our NMDA receptors on the top. Okay. I'm just going to sort of take up a little bit of space over here. So we already listed a couple things that can change. So our synapse, our synaptic contact, there's going to be some homework actually that I'm going to send out after class today about this. But if we have a single presynaptic CA3 neuron, single postsynaptic CA1 neuron, there are a few facts we need to know about the connection, in order to figure out how strong the synapse is. So we need to know the number of contacts So does it make a single point of contact? Does it make five? Does it make three like I diagrammed over there? How many branches of this presynaptic axon make contact with this? The more branches, the stronger our synapse is going to be. We also need to know the probability of neurotransmitter, in this case glutamate, being released. And we need to know the postsynaptic response to one vesicle of neurotransmitter. And so in 1949, a neurophysiologist by the name of Donald Hebb postulated that when the axon of cell A is near enough to excite cell B and repeatedly or persistently takes part in firing it, that is in causing cell B to fire its own action potential, then some growth process or change happens in one or both cells such that A's efficiency as one of the cells that drives C to fire is increased. And there's a corollary to that, which is that cells that are unsuccessful at driving synaptic responses weaken, and the neurophysiologist Carla Schatz, a couple decades later, came up with a much easier sort of thing to remember, which is cells that fire together wire together, and that corollary being use it or lose it. So these synaptic connections, when pre- and postsynaptic are active at the same time, we get calcium coming in through our NMDA receptor, and that is going to strengthen the synapse. The question for this unit for the next couple of days is what happens to strengthen the synapse? But before we get to that, I just want to revisit why strong stimulation is necessary. So in order to strengthen a synaptic connection, weak one-at-a-time vesicles isn't going to do it. We have to really strongly activate the synapse. And the reason is that if we have a single vesicle being released at a single point of contact or at three or four points of contact, then we're going to get some glutamate, but no calcium coming in through our NMDA receptor. If, however, we have strong multiple vesicles being released so that the potentials are adding on top of each other, or a lot of different synapses simultaneously active all on this one target cell, then the target cell is going to become depolarized, fire its own action potentials, and now, whichever synapses have glutamate, not all the synapses, just the ones that have glutamate, where the presynaptic cell is also active, are going to have both conditions met for the NMDA receptors, get calcium coming. And so that's going to strengthen our synaptic connection. So that's sort of taken as our starting place, that if we strongly activate a pre- and postsynaptic cell together, then the strength of that synapse is going to increase. And so the question then is, so we have three things that are going on. One is the number of contacts. Two is the probability of release. Is our postsynaptic sensitivity. Actually, I guess, so before I go on to sort of the core question here, what questions do people have about this sort of strong synapses, strong activation, strengthening a synapse? Okay, so number of points of contact, these are slow to new contacts grow very slowly. If you learn something, you can learn something within a few seconds, right? I can introduce you to somebody, and if you're not like me and terrible with names, then you can hear their name once and remember it. And it takes just a few seconds to sort of make that memory in your brain. And it takes hours for new synaptic connections to grow. So, so we're going to sort of cross this off as one of the, as a possibility for something that's going to change to form a memory, at least in terms of forming sort of an initial memory. And instead, there are we're sort of left with two possibilities. One is a sort of presynaptic strengthening, and the other is a postsynaptic strengthening. And for the basically the entirety of the 1990s, or at least especially in the first half of the 1990s, there were literally millions of dollars and literally tens of thousands of person hours spent trying to answer the question of which one is this? Is it presynaptic or postsynaptic? In addition to all that time being spent trying to answer that question, there was also a lot of very vicious argument going on. People would yell at each other at meetings about this. People would call each other terrible scientists. People would not speak to each other about this issue of whether it is a presynaptic increase in the amount of neurotransmitter coming out or a postsynaptic response to a single vesicle being released. And so it's, I mean, it's a little odd, right? This seems like a kind of like minuscule question, right? I mean, who the hell cares? More neurotransmitter, more receptors, this is whatever. So why might we care? Why does this even matter? Why should we even worry about this? Why do people get so upset with each other about this question? Yeah.
Because if your synapses are, or rather, if the synaptic communication is strengthening, then it'd be easier to like, the thought process would be faster and, you know, better. Right?
Yeah, you sort of
make people smarter.
Yeah, right? I mean, so I'm bad at names. Maybe if I took some medication that fixed something like this, I could better learn people's names or something like that. Or Alzheimer's disease, too. Or there are lots of diseases that cause difficulties with memory. Why worry about this level of detail? Okay, so we know the synapses need to get stronger. Why do we worry about this level of detail in order to figure that out? Yeah, sure.
I mean, I guess so if you were creating a drug, you know where to target.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So if we're gonna, if we've got some problem with memory, and we know that, for example, in Alzheimer's disease, the ability to strengthen a synapse in a mouse that has a mousy version of Alzheimer's disease is impaired compared to a healthy mouse brain, then that tells us that something about this is very important for health of a brain and the ability to learn things. And in fact, that's true, that diseases, when we model them in mice, cause deficits in the ability to do this. And so if I want to fix that problem, I need to know where to aim to fix it. Do I need to start making drugs that affect presynaptic function so that the presynaptic terminal can strengthen, or do I need to fix this, fix postsynaptic function? In addition to that, there actually turns out that there was a lot of ego going on with this as well. A lot of people were sort of got caught up in the argumentation behind it. So scientists are not always completely sort of dispassionate, but actually got a lot of their sort of personal worth invested into this because they'd spent years coming up with what they thought was a great reason why it was for sure presynaptic, and then somebody else comes along and says, "No, you're completely wrong." And so there's a lot of like sort of personal investment that goes on with this as well. Okay, so here is a view of the hippocampus. There are a variety of different inputs, but what we're focusing on is the CA1 neurons. One is, you see the dendrites of one in particular, CA3 neurons here. So this is one CA3 neuron with its dendrites and its axon, and one branch of that axon, which we call the Schaefer collateral, runs through to CA1 and makes contact with a bunch of these, and this is our CA1 neuron with its dendrites coming off of it. And so that's the connection that we're going to be looking at. And it ended up that during this 8-year period or so where it seemed like all of neuroscience was focused on this one particular question. The particular sort of concrete manifestation of that question people were asking was for this one particular connection. And they were interested in that connection because we knew the hippocampus was important for memory formation, and so if we're looking at changes in the brain that might be responsible for memories, the hippocampus is a reasonable place to look. It also turns out that for sort of experimental technical reasons, this is a part of the brain that we can take out of a mouse and cut up into small pieces and record and simulate one input, record the activity in the postsynaptic receiving cell, and it's very easy to keep those neurons alive for several hours after we remove them from a mouse. So that makes it sort of experimentally tractable as well. So this is Roberto Malino, and we're going to be talking about his work quite a lot over the next couple of days. And I guess just sort of in the interest of time, I'm going to skip past some of that, because I was just kind of recapping things that I already had. But I do want to sort of prepare us a little bit in the last 5 minutes here for thinking about, in particular, in a little bit more detail, this postsynaptic change here. So, backing up here to our different types of glutamate receptors, ignoring the KDA receptors for now, we've got AMPA receptors and NMDA receptors. We know that the NMDA receptors are very critical for long-term potentiation. And in fact, a number of experiments that we're not going to talk about show that if you have an antagonist that blocks NMDA receptors, doesn't matter how strongly you stimulate the presynaptic and postsynaptic cell, you're not going to get that synapse to get any stronger. So those NMDA receptors are necessary. And in addition to that, some other experiments showed that, in particular, that calcium that comes in through those NMDA receptors is absolutely vital for our ability to strengthen a synapse. So the NMDA receptors are necessary for strengthening. And that, actually, I won't even put as postsynaptic. That's just sort of another sort of starting point. Our NMDA receptors are necessary for strengthening. Skipping ahead a little bit over to here. So if you happen to be of the opinion that long-term potentiation is caused by an increase in presynaptic release, then the idea would be that when these NMDA receptors get active, calcium comes in here, and then some signal goes back up to the presynaptic terminal, which in fact is something that we know happens in a lot of cases. There are signals that travel both directions. So some signal goes back and tells the presynaptic terminal, start releasing more. This is a useful synapse. We need to strengthen it, start releasing more. If instead you're of the opinion that long-term potentiation is a postsynaptic change, then instead, when calcium comes in, you're going to have something happen locally within this postsynaptic site that causes an increase in the sensitivity to glutamate for the next time it comes around. So in another 5 minutes, when the presynaptic cell is active again, we want a bigger response. And so if we're going to get a bigger response, how do we get a bigger response to the same amount of glutamate? What are we going to change between now and 5 minutes from now about our postsynaptic site?
The voltage of the membrane of the postsynaptic cell.
That would work because you could bring yourself closer to the threshold. But one of the downsides of that is if you change the voltage of the postsynaptic cell, then all of the synapses are going to be better able to strengthen. And so we want something specifically to happen right here that's going to, in fact, that does happen. There are cases where you can change the ability of the cell in general to respond to signals. That's a second sort of substrate of memory besides synapses.
So just add more receptors.
Add more receptors, yeah. So we're going to add more receptors. So if we add more receptors, and 5 minutes later, a stimulus comes in, not a huge barrage of, learning something new, big stimulus, got something new to learn, but just, a normal sort of synaptic input comes in 5 minutes later. And we want that normal synaptic input, not the huge, like, I'm learning something, better pay attention to this. Just like, okay, same thing, seen it before. Sort of normal synaptic input, but we want a bit of a stronger response to it. And so to make it stronger postsynaptically, we add more receptors. But we need to be careful about which kind of receptors we add. So if we add a bunch of NMDA receptors to our postsynaptic cell, and then something, the synapse is active again, not crazy active, just active, is that going to change anything about the response we see? It thinks that it will. If we add a bunch more NMDA receptors, it thinks that it won't. Okay, so a few people sort of hesitantly saying that it won't. Okay, so Rolly, what do you think? Why do you think it wouldn't?
I'm not sure.
So we're sort of, we're back, kind of a clue, we're back over here. We've gone back to rest, it's 5 minutes later. And so back over here, back at resting potential, what's going on with our NMDA receptors?
They're bringing in.
There's something sort of like, if we think about it over there, when we're at rest, are we on the top half or the bottom half when we're at resting negative membrane potential?
Top half.
Top half, right. So what's different up there than the NMDA receptors?
They're close.
They're plucked.
Plugged.
Yeah, exactly right. We can add all the NMDA receptors we want. We're not going to get the synapse stronger. Instead, we're going to need to add more AMPA receptors. I'm going to send this class is basically over now, but I'm going to send out a homework assignment. And part of it will have you think about presynaptic probability, and the second part will have you think about adding more receptors and AMPA receptors. So we're going to give you a chance to work through that this afternoon, and then tomorrow we'll talk about some of the data involved in this.